Emmanuel Mudiay was ranked as the second best high school player in 2014, right behind Jahlil Okafor. Born in the Democratic Republic of Congo in 1996, Mudiay and his family endured a lot of obstacles growing up, with his father dying and his mother having trouble making ends meet. And the Second Congo War was also starting, but in 2001, Mudiay eventually escaped to the United States, where he would become a basketball star. After his senior season at Prime Prep Academy, Rivals.com ranked Mudiay as the second best high school player in the country, and it was very possible that he'd become the number one pick in the 2015 draft. That's a pretty amazing story in itself, going from a rough, poverty-stricken childhood in Congo to a potential number one pick in the NBA draft is incredible. And it was mainly because of Mudiay's relentless work ethic. And if you want to see him play, I'd recommend checking out SeatGeek. It's an app that aggregates ticket prices from all over the web to help you find the best deals for games, concerts, Broadway shows, and other events. The prices marked in green are good, while the ones in red are bad. The app is very easy to use, and you can also see the view from your seats before you buy it, which is my favorite feature. I used the app to buy tickets to a Knicks game last year, and the process was very smooth. Use my promo code ANDY at checkout to get $20 off your first purchase. Thank you to SeatGeek for sponsoring this video. Let's get started. So, after a successful high school career, players in his position typically attend a Division I college to play basketball. That's how it usually is, but for Mudiay, that's not what he wanted. Originally, he committed to play basketball at SMU, and he also got a ton of other offers from other D1 schools like Arizona, Baylor, Kansas, and Kentucky. However, he shocked the world by deciding to not even go to college, and instead he decided to play overseas in China. Now, this is nothing new. We've seen other players skip college and immediately go pro overseas, but for a high-profile top recruit like Mudiay to do that is pretty insane. I know nowadays, with the direction that college basketball is heading towards, we'll probably see a lot more high schoolers do the same thing as him. The NCAA is corrupt, that's obvious. A ton of schools are paying their student athletes under the table, and while I don't think it's a big deal, these scandals still happen every year, and it goes against the NCAA regulations. But for Mudiay, he had a very simple reason why he decided to go play in China instead. He needed the money. So he signed a one-year, $1.2 million contract to play for the Chinese Basketball League in the 2014-15 season. According to Mudiay's brother, he said that the decision was strictly financial and that he was trying to help support his mother and the rest of his immediate family. That's what he said, but some people believe that Mudiay actually had some college eligibility issues. But regardless, you can't really fault him for wanting to provide for his family as soon as possible. That was his first priority when he started to play basketball anyway. So he spent one season in China, where he appeared in only 12 games, averaging 18 points, 6 rebounds, and 6 assists per game. He had a serious ankle injury which sidelined him for about 3 months, so his short season in China quickly came to an end. As the 2015 NBA draft was getting closer, Mudiay's draft position dropped by a lot. While he was struggling with an injury in China, his peers, Jahlil Okafor, Karl-Anthony Towns, and D'Angelo Russell, were playing really well in college. Those three were in the main spotlights, while nobody really knew what was going on with Mudiay in China. As a result, Mudiay went off everyone's radar and dropped to the 7th pick of the draft. Denver selected him with the hopes that he could become their future franchise point guard. He was thrown onto a team that was going through a transition period with a weird mix of veterans and young prospects who, frankly, not many people knew about at the time. The team was led by veteran Danilo Gallinari, who was basically injured every other game. But honestly, Mudiay was the guy that everyone was paying attention to. A lot of people were aware of how great he was in high school, so the 19-year-old had high expectations in the NBA. In his rookie season, it was kinda rough. Mudiay showed flashes of brilliance with his athleticism and playmaking, as he had multiple games of 20 points and multiple games of 10 or more assists. But overall, he was very inconsistent, and on some nights, he just could not hit a shot. On top of all this, he had trouble finishing at the rim, hitting only 47% of his shots between 0 and 3 feet, which is about 10% below the league's average. Mudiay finished his rookie season with averages of nearly 13 points and 6 assists per game, which looks okay. But then you take a look at his efficiency, which was putrid. He was well below average from all areas of the floor, mid-range, at the rim, three-point land, everything was really bad. And out of all qualified players who averaged at least 13 field goal attempts per game, Mudiay had the lowest true shooting percentage that season. He also averaged over 3 turnovers per game. But even with his rather terrible play, at the time everyone thought, well, he's just a rookie. He was a 19-year-old rookie, and most 19-year-old rookies are not good at all in their first season. With a few exceptions, of course. Basically, Mudiay needs more time, which is perfectly fine. Oh, and he also suffered an ankle injury early in the season, so that was just another obstacle in his development. Despite his terribly inconsistent play, Mudiay has still shown bursts of excellence. In the future, if he can improve his shooting and stay somewhat consistent, then he'd be on the right path. Unfortunately, Mudiay's sophomore season in the NBA was not much better. His shooting ability slightly improved, but for the most part, he still couldn't shoot. In the 2016-17 season, he played off the ball much more, but he was not a good off-ball player either. He's basically one of those players who's only effective with the ball in his hands, but at the same time, he wasn't really effective at all. He did have that moment in the beginning of the season where he scored 24 points in the first quarter against the Celtics. But for the rest of the season, it was pretty much the same as his rookie season. Also, this was the season where the Nuggets realized that they had a gem in Nikola Jokic, who they started running the offense through because he was a much better passer, scorer, playmaker, and much better than Mudiay at everything. Towards the end of the season, Mudiay even racked up a bunch of DNPs because he was playing so poorly on both ends of the floor. The Nuggets preferred to play a 34-year-old Jameer Nelson instead of Mudiay. That's how bad it was. The team also drafted Jamal Murray in the 2016 draft, another guard, and he looked a lot better as a rookie than Mudiay did as a sophomore. So yeah, Murray basically took Mudiay's spot in the rotation, which was totally fair. Murray deserved it. He was a better shooter, better defender, and he just played with a lot more effort. Mudiay finished the season averaging 11 points and 4 assists per game and didn't improve that much. Instead of making the jump that everyone expected, Mudiay lost the starting point guard job and saw his minutes decrease even more. The next season, his third season with the Nuggets, saw the same trend. Mudiay's minutes decreased even more, his shooting was still awful, and there's nothing more to it. At this point, the Nuggets made it clear that Jamal Murray was the future point guard of the team right when the season started. When asked about Mudiay's playing time, Coach Mike Malone said, "If Emmanuel is called upon, he'll go out there to the best of his ability. If tonight is not his night, we'll go with the group we have, but no decision has been made on that. Who will play and who won't play. Each game kind of takes on its own personality when the game starts." So I think it's clear that Mudiay was no longer a priority for the team. But in my opinion, I think it was a bit unfair to him. As the coach, Mike Malone has to put the best product on the floor, but I feel like he was too impatient with Mudiay. He only gave Mudiay about 100 games as the starting point guard, and then gave up on him, even though he was barely 20 years old. That's way too young, especially since Mudiay was supposed to have one of the highest potentials in his draft. It sucks that the Nuggets basically threw him to the side, but it makes sense from their perspective. They realized they can compete for a playoff spot right now, so they needed to win games, and that was not happening with Mudiay. According to NBA.com, the Nuggets were 12 points per 100 possessions better with Mudiay on the bench. Yikes. Instead of waiting around for Mudiay to develop, they traded him in a three-team deal that sent Mudiay to the Knicks, and in return they got Devin Harris, a steady, veteran point guard. On the Knicks, Mudiay doesn't look any different than before. He still shows flashes of all-star potential, but as always, he's still very inconsistent. Every time he'd have a great game, scoring 20 points on great efficiency, he'd follow that up with a string of really bad games. It's been like this for years, and it's infuriating to watch him. One day, it looks like he's getting it together, then the next day, it looks like he doesn't even belong in the NBA. It's also weird that the Knicks wanted him in the first place because he's taking minutes away from their own prospect, Frank Ntilikina. But Knicks GM Scott Perry said that they were in a talent acquisition phase and they envisioned that the two of them can compete and play alongside one another. I guess they're hoping that at least one of them will become good. But anyway, that sums up Mudiay's NBA career up until now. I hope he can find a place in the NBA or a team that can be more patient with him. I still believe in him. His athleticism is off the charts, but it just hasn't led to any success on the court. He's only 22 years old though, and I don't think anyone should be giving up on a 22-year-old guy who was once considered as a potential number one pick in his draft. And that's all, folks. I hope you enjoyed that video. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time. Peace.